Our next speaker is Alexander Changenet. He comes also from INRA Bordeaux. He's going to talk about drought-induced mortality, occurrence, and abundance in tree species. So,
thank you. Hi, everyone. I'm Alexandre Changenet. I'm a third-year PhD student working in Bordeaux in Bugeco, and I will present to you the work that I've been doing the last 2 years. So this is the first paper. I have something to say. First, I'm red-green colorblind, and I don't see the pointer, so I won't use it. No, it's just that I'm not seeing it. Okay. Okay, thank you. So global temperature are rising, increasing CO2 atmospheric concentrations, changes in land use and forest management, all that have altered biodiversity and production of terrestrial biosphere. So in summary, climate change is having important impact on global biodiversity. Particularly on slow-shifting organisms such as trees. We can see that through demography and, for instance, on mortality that have been recorded to be on the rise all around the world. I'm going to tell you about two types of mortality, so I need to precise that. Background mortality, that is also called the regular mortality, is the mortality that happens in forest. This is the theoretical stable rate of mortality in the absence of catastrophic events. By opposition, you can find dieback mortality, that is an intense event of mortality as a response to catastrophic events such as heat waves, drought, insect outbreaks, and things like that. Tree mortality is important to be understood because it has an impact on forest community, ecosystem dynamics, and also has social consequences. However, identifying the drivers across large environmental gradients remains challenging because sensitivity to biotic and abiotic factors varies along with species and with ecological strategies as well. Also, mortality is really difficult to predict because it's both stochastic and multifactorial. We start to understand a bit how it is going in Europe. For instance, here you have a map of mortality of Pinus sylvestris. But we need to understand better how it works with many species. So I've been working with national forest inventories data from six countries: Spain, France, Wallonia, Germany, Finland, and Sweden. I worked with more than 2 million trees, and I've modeled mortality in 20 different species. So from my national forest inventories data, I calculated two mortality responses that I have used to calibrate two different models. I have calculated an occurrence of mortality model. So the question is, can we find mortality or not in the plot? So it's a binomial response. And I have calculated an annual rate of mortality in a model called amount of mortality model. So the question this time is not, can we find mortality? Is there is mortality, how much? And this is a negative binomial response. From my national forest inventories data, I was able to calculate competition indexes as well. So interspecific and intraspecific competition indexes that were included in my model as well as covariable. Then I've included climatic variables, one temperature-related variable, and one precipitation-related variable, and I have also calculated a marginality index that has been included as a qualitative variable in the model. I will tell you more about it now. So first, I'm taking the species distribution, and I'm extracting the values of 21 climatic variables. Then I'm performing a weighted PCA. And based on the scores of the two first axes, I splitted my points in three categories. You have the core area, and then the marginal points have been sent for a clustered analysis, and they are separated into leading edge and trailing edge areas. Then this is projected on the map, and every plot that I have that fall in the leading or trailing or core areas are labeled trailing or leading or core areas. And this is included in the model as a qualitative variable. Well, from that, I have tested three hypotheses. First hypothesis, occurrence and amount of mortality are not driven by the same factors. Second hypothesis, marginal populations experience higher occurrence of mortality than core population. And the third hypothesis, mortality amount is patchily distributed across the species ranges. So I'm going to present you the main tendency that I have observed in my data. This is the result for one single species, so I please you to believe me, this is the main tendency that I observe for my 20 species. So when we look at the mortality occurrence probability as a response to drought, what we see, so drought index is, I still don't know how to use that. Drought index, more negative values in drought index means drier conditions. So what we see here is that for trailing edge and leading edge populations that are respectively in red and blue, in the same dry condition, we observe more mortality than core populations. And this is what we observe for most of the species in my dataset. So drought was the most important driver of the occurrence of mortality. Then when we look at the impact of temperatures on the amount of mortality, what we see and the main tendency once again, so before it was for PCR abies, sorry I didn't say that, and this is for Fraxinus excelsior. The main tendency was that the main driver of the amount of mortality was temperatures, especially at the leading edge, and it was a mixture of all the variables at the trailing edge population. So sometimes it was competition, sometimes it was drought, sometimes it was temperature. So no clear pattern. For the second hypothesis, here what you have on the right is the map of the predicted occurrence probability of mortality. Red dots indicate largest values and blue dots indicate the smallest values. And on the bar plot, you have the distribution of these points in the three areas, trailing edge, leading edge, and core areas. So under the assumption of no special pattern, we expect the distribution of the point to be flat, while we expect no pattern, so equally distribution between blue and red points as well, which is not the case. We can see that at the trailing edge, this is the one on the right, we have another representation of largest values, and on the leading edge in the center, we have another representation of smaller values, which basically means that at the trailing edge, these species die more than in the core, and that the leading edge, it dies less than expected in the other areas. So this tendency was also what I observed for most of the species in my dataset. Then when I do the same thing for the amount of mortality, when I project it on the map, what we see is no clear pattern. For most of the species, we did not have such a pattern as we had for occurrence of mortality models. So from these two hypotheses, we suggest that maybe the occurrence of mortality models could represent background mortality that we expect to be larger in the south, and on the other hand, mortality amount model could represent dieback events that we expect to be more patchily distributed. So, four main messages. First, the occurrence of mortality was mostly related to drought, especially at the trailing edge. And amount of mortality depends on many other drivers in addition to drought. The highest occurrence of mortality was found at the trailing edge of the runs for many forestry species. Mortality amount did not show such a clear pattern, so we did not find particular pattern. And finally, from the two last messages, maybe we can distinguish background and dieback mortality from national forest inventories data. These results suggest first that population at the margins may suffer from increased mortality rates in the coming decades, and maybe forest management and conservation practices should be revisited in these strategic areas. I want to thank all my collaborators and Gentry for inviting me and let me speak today. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you. We have time for a few questions.
From the University of Thessaloniki, Greece, and I would like to ask you if the mortality you estimated or you recorded, if you had the chance to record also the regeneration after the dieback, because dieback might be an event due to climate or whatever, drought incidents, but the issue is for conservation at least, what's going on with regeneration of it?
Well, this is actually what I'm doing now, the second chapter of my PhD. I'm working on recruitment and growth, but it's complicated to estimate. It's mortality is also complicated, but recruitment from national forest and inventories data is really hard. But this is what I'm doing now.
Sylvie Muratorio, INRA Avignon. So thanks, what's very interesting. You seem to have different trends in the occurrence versus amount of mortality. So for what concerns the trailing and the leading edge, occurrence of mortality, they pretty fit the definition of marginality. And the amount, not that much. Maybe the amount of mortality depends on much more characteristics of the stems. You include competition in your model. Would like tree age, species diversity? I mean, would any other characters be interested to account for, or in which one?
Yes, but actually we use the average DBH of the plot as a proxy of age, and we use a couple of variables. But in my opinion, what we lack a lot is data about insect attacks and stuff like that. But I think so. But even though it could be included in the model, I wouldn't expect to observe a pattern, because intense events are really, I don't know how to say that. Patchy and rare, so I don't know.
David Sims are coming, Forest Research Institute, Freiburg. I was wondering about your data set, because you're talking about drought-induced mortality, right, across several species. And you also showed the results from Fraxinus excelsior, where we have a lot of ash dieback problems. I was wondering if the data set is data set defined, this is due to drought or both, or if there's any explanation for that, or if you ever accounted for it?
I'm not sure to understand. You said for the amount of mortality models, for instance?
Yeah.
Well, you mean because it's because of the disease and things like that?
Yeah.
Yeah, I cannot. Well, I can see if drought or temperatures are significant in my model, but maybe if I could include pests or things like that, it would be more significant, but I don't have data about it.
No, I was wondering about your data. Data is provided to this website or NI, what was that, NI6? Six countries, mm-hmm. based on different 20 species. Are they provided based on, basically, they're sure that it's from drought, this mortality results, or it's...
No.
Could be also confused with the result.
No, in my data,
mortality from the
tree is just noted as dead. That's it. And
okay, so
I'm.
It could be anything.
It could be anything.
Okay, so then it might be worth to look into it because it could be misleading.
Yeah, but the thing is, we have no data to quantify that. So what I was trying to do is to. Like correlated somehow with the drought index that we can calculate and the climatic variables, but could be something else. We do not account in the model, yes, yeah. Sure.